Good morning. Today is the solemnity of the most holy body and blood of Christ. Just so you know, the graduation mass is today at 11, not next week at 11. There will be a second collection for St. Mary's Seminary for support of men studying for the priesthood in our archdiocese and the religious communities. Please stand and join us in singing Table of Plenty.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you are the great high priest, offering an endless prayer of praise to God. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you give us your body and blood as strength of our journey of conversion. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you come in word and sacrament to bring peace to your people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will.
Christ, holy begotten Son,
Lord God.
us pray. O God, who in this wonderful sacrament have left us a memorial of your passion, grant us, we pray, so to revere the sacred mysteries of your body and blood, that we may always experience in ourselves the fruits of your redemption, who live and reign, God the Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. When Moses came to the people and related all the words and ordinances of the Lord, they all answered with one voice, "We will do everything that the Lord has told us." Moses then wrote down all the words of the Lord, and, rising early the next day, he erected at the foot of the mountain an altar and 12 pillars for the 12 tribes of Israel. Then, having sent certain young men of the Israelites to offer holocausts and sacrifice young bulls as peace offerings to the Lord, Moses took half of the blood and put it in large bowls. The other half he splashed on the altar. Taking the book of the covenant, he read it aloud to the people, who answered, "All that the Lord has said, we will heed and do." Then he took the blood and sprinkled it on the people, saying, "This is the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words of his." The word of the Lord.
Take the call.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, when Christ came as high priest of the good things that have come to be, passing through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made by hands, that is, not belonging to this creation, he entered once and for all into the sanctuary, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls and the sprinkling of heifer's ashes can sanctify those who are defiled so that their flesh is cleansed, how much more with the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from dead works to worship the living God. For this reason, he is mediator of a new covenant, since a death has taken place for deliverance from transgressions under the first covenant. Those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance. The word of the Lord.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples said to him, "Where do you want us to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?" He sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the city, and a man will meet you carrying a jar of water. Follow him. Wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' Then he will show you a large upper room furnished and ready. Make the preparations for us there." The disciples then went off, entered the city, and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. While they were eating, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, gave it to them, and said, "Take it. This is my body." Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed for many. Amen, I say to you, I shall not drink again the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good morning. Today, the church celebrates the solemnity of the most holy body and blood of Christ. You might have heard of the study that came out a few years ago saying that only 63% of Catholics who attend Mass weekly believe in the real presence of Jesus. Now, that has not been my experience as a priest. I found that people come into Mass, especially here at St. Faustina, take the Eucharist very seriously. I thought it'd be good to go ahead today and make sure we're all on the same page. When a priest says the words of institution given to us by the church over bread and wine, what occurs is something called transubstantiation, where the substance of the bread and wine, what they are, changes into the body and blood of Jesus, while the accidents or external characteristics of them remain the same. So maybe it's helpful to say what we don't believe. We don't believe that it's merely symbolic, where the no change actually occurs and the bread and wine simply point to something else. We also don't believe in transformation, where the bread and wine would start to look and taste like skin and bones and blood. Now, the second one, transformation, might sound more amazing. So you may ask, why doesn't God just do that? Wouldn't that help our faith? Why doesn't God actually transform the bread and wine into skin and tendons and ligaments? Well, he sometimes does with Eucharistic miracles. There's lots of recorded cases of this happening that you can actually check out. But generally speaking, you know how uncomfortable it would be for us to be tearing up and eating what looked like bloody human flesh. That would be so hard for us psychologically. God is gentle. He allows it to keep looking and tasting like common bread and wine, very accessible. But what it truly becomes is the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus Christ. Now, transubstantiation is unique to the Eucharist. Nothing else does this. It's the only thing that happens. Okay, so that's what we should believe as Catholics, that the bread and wine actually become the body and blood of Jesus while still looking and tasting like bread and wine. Now, if you don't believe that, if you don't believe it actually becomes Jesus, then please come talk to me. This is a big deal, and I'm happy to discuss it more. A friend mentioned recently that one of their relatives was interested in the Catholic faith. They enjoyed Mass, thought confession made sense, they agreed with most of the teachings. They just didn't believe that the Eucharist was Jesus. They liked the Catholic faith, just not the Eucharist. And I wanted to tell them, the Catholic faith is the Eucharist. The Eucharist is Jesus. So the Catholic faith without Jesus is pretty pointless. This is a core teaching. If the Catholic Church is wrong about the Eucharist, then she's wrong about everything. And all this is helpful to keep in mind when we talk about live streaming the Mass. Yes, live streaming the Mass is still an option. We don't have the obligation again to come to Mass. Watching Mass is a good thing to do. But I think it's helpful to be clear that video chatting someone is not the same as actually being with them. Even more, watching someone eat dinner is not the same thing as eating dinner with them. When you come to Mass, you get to actually receive the Eucharist physically. Sacraments are physical, and having the body of Jesus present and our bodies present makes all the difference. Now, some practical notes on receiving communion. First, you want to make sure that you're in a state of grace, meaning you haven't committed a mortal sin since your last confession. If you have, then make sure you go to confession before receiving communion again. Second, make sure that you fast. Church law says that we can only have water or medicine, so no other food or drinks, in the 1 hour before receiving communion. Now, that's not necessarily 1 hour before Mass starts. That's just 1 hour before actually receiving communion. So it might depend on who's preaching. Now, for actually receiving, you have two options. You can receive on the hand or on the tongue. If you're receiving on the hand, the bishops say, if one is right-handed, the left hand should be rest upon the right. The host will then be laid in the palm of the left hand and then taken by the right hand to the mouth. If one is left-handed, this is reversed. So this means you don't put your hands side by side. You actually stack them one on top of the other. Also, it's helpful if you hold your hands up about shoulder level, not too high, not too low. And please keep your hands and fingers flat. If they're hyperextended or slanted, the host can slide off. The bishops also say, and this is important, it is not appropriate to reach out with the fingers and take the host from the person distributing. Theologically, it's significant that we receive it. Please don't break the host, as this will create more pieces of Jesus on your hands, and always be sure to check for any remaining particles after you receive. If you're receiving on the tongue, which is another great option, please open your mouth wide and stick your tongue out flat. You want your tongue to be parallel to the ground, not perpendicular, and please don't lick my fingers. It happens. Also, kind of a pro tip, closing your eyes can sometimes be helpful so that you're not tracking the host. It's more helpful if you kind of close your eyes and you stay still, and I'll make sure I get the host where it needs to be. The person distributing communion says audibly to each person approaching the body of Christ. Then the communicant should audibly respond, amen. So we say amen, not I believe, or thanks be to God, or thank you. People sometimes say, I know what the church teaches about the Eucharist, but some days I just don't feel it. I'm at Mass, but I just don't feel like it's actually Jesus. And I always say, well, thank God it's not based on your feelings. Thank God the truth doesn't change like your feelings do day to day. When I say the words of consecration of the bread and wine, whether or not it works isn't based on if I'm feeling it that day. Belief is a choice, not a feeling. And how beautiful is it that on the days you come here and you aren't feeling it, you still get Jesus anyways. Because he promised. He promised to be with us in the Eucharist on the days we feel it and on the days we don't. Final thought. Someone asked me recently, why do we have to eat the body of Jesus? Can't we just adore it, look at it, be with it? Why do we have to actually eat it? And as I was reflecting on this, I ran into a quote from St. Peter Julian Aimard. He said, when we work hard, we must eat well. So receive communion often, and Jesus will change you into himself. Friends, there's a lot to be done in this life. Evil is real, and this world needs saints. You'll have to work hard. So eat well. Receive communion often, and Jesus will change you into himself.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son is adored and glorified,
who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
God's only Son gave his very body and blood to save us from our sins. And so we are assured of God's great generosity as we express our needs and ask for his assistance.
That all Christians, nourished body and blood of Christ, may go forth into the world to share the mercy and love of God with those most in need. Let us pray to the Lord. For our leaders, that they may strive to ensure that no one in this wealthy nation is left starving or malnourished, no matter their circumstances. Let us pray to the Lord. For all those who regularly go hungry and thirsty, who never experience the assurance of having plenty to eat and drink, that they may be showered with the Lord's bounty, let us pray to the Lord. For those in our parish who are unable to join us in person, and for the ministers of communion who bring the Eucharist to them, let us pray to the Lord. That God will raise up to new life those who have died in the peace of Christ. Let us pray to the Lord. And for those in our community who are suffering physically and emotionally, and for all the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts, for all our intentions spoken and unspoken, let us pray to the Lord.
Bountiful God, you have nourished and strengthened us with the living bread and precious blood come down from heaven. May we be Eucharist for others so that all may share in your lavish generosity as you listen to our prayers. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Live and live.
pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and all his holy church.
Grant your church, O Lord, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace, whose signs are to be seen in mystery in the offerings we here present, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For at the Last Supper with his apostles, establishing for ages to come the saving memorial of the cross, he offered himself to you as the unblemished Lamb, the acceptable gift of perfect praise. Nourishing your faithful by this sacred mystery, you make them holy, so that the human race, bounded by one world, may be enlightened by one faith and united by one bond of charity. And so we approach the table of this wondrous sacrament, so that bathed in the sweetness of your grace, we may pass over to the heavenly realities here foreshadowed. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth sing a new song in adoration, and we with all the host of angels cry out, and without end we acclaim. You, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Dame, our Bishop, and all those who are holding to the truth and on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls and hope of health and well-being, and paying homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers and all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect, make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands. Once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the blessed passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. And let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room.
Only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
I
Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that we may delight for all eternity in that share in your divine life, which is foreshadowed in the present age by our reception of your precious body and blood, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Communion for the sick and homebound. Do we have anybody? Maybe not. Maybe not. Okay, we'll get it afterwards. Three announcements today. First, just a reminder about our Loving Embrace ministry. We'll be having an informational session tomorrow evening after the 6:30 p.m. Mass on that. Members of this ministry will be a reflection of the corporal and spiritual works of mercy to those in need. All are invited to attend. Also, the Spanish Choir will host a night of praise and adoration of the Blessed Sacrament this Thursday, June 10th, right after the 6:30 p.m. evening Mass. Adoration will begin at 7:30 p.m., and all are invited to this as well. If you haven't already, you should be receiving a letter with information on next weekend's Masses, when we will, as a community, reflect and grieve together on the struggles, the loss of a loved one, or any other loss you may have experienced during this pandemic year. So there's a page with blue hearts, and so you can either put a picture of a loved one you may have lost throughout the year or write down some kind of loss and then bring that to Masses next weekend. And we will grieve those together as a community. And then the following weekend, we'll come together to celebrate the blessings we received during the pandemic. So in that same letter, there's a yellow sheet with pictures of the sun where you can write the blessings you have received, and we'll celebrate those together as a community the following week in June 20th.
The minister's there.
I guess, okay, good. As you bring Christ to those in need, may you also bring our love and prayers, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you.
With
may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. The Mass has ended. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Blessed be your name. Every blessing.